And now it's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Sood, a professor and vice dean for research and faculty affairs at the USC Price School of Public Policy. And he's a founding member of the USC Schaefer Center. And he's going to be able to speak a bit more on the serology study. Thank you, Dr. Nood.
Thank you, Dr. Ferrer and Supervisor Barker, for having me here. Before I talk about the study, I want to acknowledge all the people and the organizations that contributed to the study. So this is a true public-private partnership between USC, LA County Public Health, and the LA City Mayor's Office. This study would not be possible without the leadership and vision of Dr. Ferrer and Dr. Paul Simon, who is the Chief Science Officer for LA County Public Health. I also want to acknowledge President Carol Fold, who provided funding for the study, as well as the Jadel Foundation, the USC Schwarzenegger Institute, USC Lust Center, and many individual donors who contributed to this public health study. We had a lot of volunteers for the study, especially Keck medical students, and I want to thank them for their time that they devoted to the study. So now, what did we find? There were two important findings. The first finding was that, as Dr. Ferrer mentioned, when we tested about 863 individuals who were representative of LA County, about 4.1% of them tested positive. And now we know the population of Los Angeles of adults in Los Angeles County is about 8 million. So if you take that population of 8 million and apply the 4.1%, what we get is about 320,000 adults in Los Angeles County who have had a COVID infection before April 9th, before we started doing the testing. You compare this to the confirmed cases of COVID-19 in Los Angeles County, what we get is that the number of true infections based on the study is 40 times larger than the number of confirmed cases. So this highlights the importance of using serology testing to continue to monitor this disease. Serology testing can provide important information on the true extent of the infection in our communities. The implications of these findings are twofold. One, it says that mortality rates estimated based on confirmed cases are going to be much higher than mortality rates estimated based on the number of infections or the estimated number of infections. So we could say maybe the good news is that the fatality rate is lower than what we thought it would be. But the fatality rate is not the only number we should focus on. That is not the only number that determines the burden of disease. What the findings show is that only 4% of our population has been infected, which means we are very early in the epidemic, and many more people in LA County could potentially be infected. And as those number of infections rise, so will the number of deaths, the number of hospitalizations, and the number of ICU admissions. So the study says we need to continue monitoring this epidemic through serology testing and other means. We need to take the data we are getting and update and recalibrate our models of what would happen in the future as more people get infected, and then ultimately use these better models, the more accurate data, to guide public policy decisions about how to combat this epidemic. Thank you. Grace, we are ready for questions.
Came out on Friday, got a little bit of criticism for its the way it was compiled because it was sort of a self-selected group of people that were recruited via social media, and that led to some concerns there may be some self-selection bias in the sample. My understanding is that the adults that participated in the LA County study were recruited via marketing firms, but can you talk a little bit more about how we should understand this sample, and is it true to say that this is a randomized sample, which I know is the gold standard for these type of community surveillance studies?
Sure. So we worked with a market research firm called the LRW Group, and they have a database of email addresses as well as phone numbers of people residing in Los Angeles County. And we picked a random number of emails or phone numbers to contact for people to help to participate in this study. So in that sense, it was a random sample, that it was a random sample picked from this database maintained by the market research firm LRW. And then we set quotas based on the demographic distribution of LA County. So we wanted our sample to try to mimic LA County in terms of its age distribution, gender distribution, race, ethnicity. So that was the process we followed to try to make the sample representative.
Thank you. Next, we'll go to the line of Patrick Healy with NBC4. Please go ahead.
Hi, thank you very much. Also interested in the serology study. First of all, could you tell us what was the rate of false positives and false negatives that you established for the study? And then could you comment on some of the results, the startling results that men are three times more likely than women to have been positive? And again, the Latinx shows such a disproportionately low percentage. Thank you.
Thank you for that question. So we have two sets of data on the sensitivity and the specificity of the test we used. One comes from the manufacturer of the firm from which we got the test kits, and this is the data they reported to the FDA. And the other comes from an assessment done at a lab at Stanford where we took the test kits and we tested them. So the question about the false positives, the manufacturer of the kit tested 371 samples, which were confirmed COVID negative samples, and they report that the test accurately identified 369 of the 371 as confirmed negative. So in other words, the false positive rate is 2 out of 371, which would be 99.5% specificity, or a false positive rate of 0.5%. In the independent assessment done at the lab at Stanford, there were two samples. One, the first sample was 30, and the next sample was 88, and the test had zero false positives in those. So it had a specificity of 100%. So in general, based on these two assessments, we think that the false positive rate of the test is really low. And when we do our statistical analysis, we are going to adjust our estimates of the prevalence based on the false positive rate or the specificity of the test, as well as based on the sensitivity of the test or the false negative rate of the test. The other question was, what do we make of the findings that, you know, more men were infected versus the differences across race and ethnicities? I think those findings are very preliminary. We haven't done the proper statistical analysis on them to see if they are, you know, just chance or whether they are really statistically different from each other. So I would not want to comment on those findings right now.
Could you say what the company was that supplied this serology test? You know, what do we know about the accuracy of that particular test? And then the number you quoted for population of LA County being 8 million, is that because we're just looking at adults? Could you confirm that?
Yes, so I'll take the last question first. According to the census, the population of LA County is around 10 million, and about 8 million of them are adults. So the 8 million population is just for adults. On the company that whose test we use, the company is called Premier Biotech, and it's based in Minnesota. Premier Biotech has submitted their data to the FDA. They have a letter to the FDA on their website. And that data reports the sensitivity and the specificity of the test. So based on that data, the specificity of the test was around 99.5%, as I told earlier, and the sensitivity of the test was greater than 90%. There were two separate assessments where we used a small sample of patients at a lab in Stanford and try to assess the sensitivity of the test. In those assessments, the sensitivity varied from about 72% to 93%. And when we do the analysis, again, it's important to remember that we're just doing the analysis to count the expected number of people in Los Angeles County who've been infected. So we adjust our analysis for accounting for the specificity and the sensitivity of the test. So we take into account the accuracy and then we readjust our statistical analysis. So I think that answers that question. Thanks.
Thank you.